Thanks for coming, everyone. Welcome. This presentation is a part of a longer project that Philip and I probably started in Oslo, maybe before that. We've updated it. This will hopefully appear, part of this work will appear in the ARP volume 2 when it arrives. The rationale for this project really was to locate the engineer as someone who is a creative practitioner. Sound engineers have historically been viewed as mere technicians. As a number of talks over the last couple of days have shown, they are sometimes underrepresented in the narrative of popular music creation. And in fact, some of these ideas are from art history, and they are embedded into the romantic cultures of the popular music industry because of these long-held ideas that there is somehow a difference between art and craft. This view considers art to be the pure expression of emotion. It's only accomplished through the creation of the work. However, this view also has something in common with the divine inspiration view, which, as the research literature tells us, is a problematic conception of creativity.
Okay, so we're going to bounce back and forth a little bit here, and in one slide we've demonstrated that there's a large body of research literature on creativity. There's been a movement in that literature, at least over the last 60 to 80 years, away from romanticism, inspirationism, into what I call confluence models of creativity, and this is one of them. Just before I explain what Chicks and I is talking about, which I do a lot, I would suggest that we, and I've heard it across this conference again, tend to conflate creativity down with artistic activity. Whereas in the research literature, creativity and artistic activity are in a relationship in the same way as media to journalism is a conflation down. Creativity gets conflated right down to artistic activity quite quickly, but it's much broader than that inside the research literature itself. So just a quick definition. Creativity is the bringing into being of novel things, products, processes, etc., that are valued in at least one social setting. That's a fairly standard definition inside that, this research world. Here's one of those confluence models that we've particularly working with. It's this particular thing here, systems model of creativity. This is a redevelopment of it by Susan Carey in 2013. But there are three essential subsystems within this system, and that question of subsystems is really important. There's an agent, a decision-making body, an entity, so on, person, group, institution, whatever. There's a body of knowledge, a set of codes, a simple system, or whatever, that this entity accesses, interacts with. And there are, of course, a field of people who have some degree of understanding of this particular knowledge, who then can influence the relationship or the changes in this knowledge system. So that's it, kind of there. The last talk I was hearing systems words popping up all the time. Emergence is one of them. As you'll see, second scalability is another. So this is not just a single system that we're talking about, it's a representation of a system, and all systems are vertically scalable and horizontally integrated. So Csikszentmihalyi explains it in a particular way. That's what we're talking about when we use that one word.
So in actuality, this is a model. And one of the problems that Philip and I have always come up against is the way in which this is represented. It's represented as relatively straightforward, that there are three separate elements, but actually these are all integrated, and as you'll see, as we contextualise the elements of the creative system, they're actually all intertwined. They're all codependent and all interdependent and concurrent. So the recording engineer, who is potentially this agent, this person who is able to rearrange the domain in a novel way and present their ideas to the field, at which, once it's accepted by the social organisation, emerges particular creative practices. And that was Susan Kelly's massive contribution to work in this field. David Beard talks about recording engineers in his book. He says recording engineers, as they fit into studio-based hierarchies, can be thought of as concealed agents making often unknown contributions to the sonic properties of culture. We know little of how their knowledge is formed, of their sense of community, of their mediating role in production processes, of their technical skills, of their sense of identity, or of their work or their qualifications. And Eber Keeley mentions that sound engineers' work represents the point where music and modern technology meet. Alvin Zach also makes the point that, in fact, engineers are responsible for quite a lot of the things that we hear on a record.
And I think you could see in this diagram some of the illustrations of the knowledge system that engineers will have to engage with in one way or another. You know, there's questions of mic selection, there's questions about understanding acoustics, sometimes psychoacoustics, etc. Instruments themselves, you know, the grand and acoustic guitar, how that produces particular sounds and so on. And mixing consoles, of course, which have become instrumental in the whole process. Processing systems, monitoring, understanding what sort of monitors you can use and what effect that could have on placement. All sorts of things going on in here, but also musical elements as well. Having some understanding, at least, of the basic parts of music. And certainly styles, genres, and so on that you can be employed for particular genres across a whole career. But there's also a whole series of contextual and socio-cultural elements in there. We were talking about it earlier this morning, some psychological personality understandings and so on. But there was also domain-specific terminology that you have to come to grips with. There's a whole list of them. I think I can't remember whose presentation it was about being muddy, about being sharp, about being present, and so on. All these things that you need to have to some understanding in order to contribute to what the field of domain is doing.
So, traditionally, as has been mentioned, this knowledge was generally passed on, certainly in larger recording facilities, through a semi-formal apprenticeship. Well-known recording studios. This led to a succession of engineers, Jeff Emmerich, Ken Scott, and Alan Parsons being just one example of that. That might be non-formal as well. Some engineers entered the field through either setting up their own studio, maybe even at smaller facilities. Certainly in the 1950s in the United States, we saw the growth of entrepreneurial engineers, people who owned and operated their own recording studios, largely because of the reduction in the cost of those recording technologies. And then more contemporary forms of domain acquisition of engineering. We see it may be some educational courses, whether that be further education or TAFE, or also in higher education as well. So in order to become an engineer, in whichever way they do it, engineers have to acquire this body of knowledge, this cultural matrix, and this symbol system.
And of course, the other part of the system is that in the field, you have to get to know the processes that people are interested in. So if you think of field as people, you think of domain as knowledge, books or whatever. That might be the image to hold in your head. There's a whole series of things that you need to understand about the way that the field works. And here we're kind of drawing on Bourdieu's notion of social capital more than anything else, how all those interactions take place. But also, I think importantly, inside the field, how power works, how power is transformative for certain people and not so transformative for others as well, how you get people to do things that you want them to do, and so on, how those negotiations take place. So there's a whole series of things that you're not only learning in terms of knowledge systems, but there are also a whole series of things that you need to learn about social interaction. And I think that's what the engineer's field is primarily concerned with.
So we're going to provide a really quick, brief example to illustrate how the creative system operates within a very particular one. Ignore that slide, that shouldn't have been in there. It's a very small instance of Bruce Swidian, who is the main engineer on Michael Jackson's Off the Wall. In fact, engineered a lot of his records. And the engineer in this system is someone who acquired the domain in lots of different situations. He mentioned in his book, at the age of 15, he began working in a basement recording studio in Minneapolis, where he grew up. he says, my summer vacations from school were spent recording any willing musical group. During high school, I recorded everything from Minnesota-type polka bands to black gospel singing quartets in the living room. He then moved on to work in the University of Minnesota's recording department. He actually helped with building that and converting it. And then later at Chicago's Universal Studios, under chief engineer Bill Putnam. So we also see a more structured process of domain acquisition, as well as the less structured one, recording at home. As Alvin's Zach states, the engineer's job is to translate. It's to translate musical ideas, humor, presence, artistic personalities, the sounds of instruments and voices into the medium of recording. And this is generally done quite often through this process of microphoning, or miking for short. He also explains that he sees microphones in the same way a painter sees paintbrushes. They all do pretty much the same thing, but each has its own characteristics and best applications. So this is the very specific example of working with Michael Jackson that Bruce William mentions in his book. And so we've also picked a particular track for this. It's Rock With You, written by English songwriter Rod Temperton, of which when I got hold of the multi-tracks, I realised there's also a Rod Temperton temp track on it, which sounds dreadful, so I'm not going to play that. But essentially, this is where Bruce William was attempting to use his domain knowledge, employ it in a very particular way, and also employ it in a novel way. We can also see some of his sensibilities in the way in which he recorded particular instruments. So he mentions here recording the backing vocals for a lot of Michael's tracks, but as he mentioned here, it's very prominent in the example that I'm going to play to you called Rock With You. And what he would do, he would normally start by recording a monophonic track close to the microphone, and then he'd ask Michael Jackson to then perform a backing vocal, a harmony vocal, or sometimes a double vocal. Then take another step back and record the same. Take another step back and record a harmony, etc. You would also use a stereo one-line pair as well, and also ask them to record that. And what that does is it introduces early reflections into the recorded signal through that process. And it also introduces it through through the stereo aspect of left and right. So I just wanted to play this example to you.
Lay back and groove with mine. You gotta feel that heat. And we can ride the boogie sham, that beat of love.
That's the main lead vocal.
Lay back and groove with mine. You gotta feel that heat. And we can ride the boogie, share that beat of love. I wanna rock with you all night.
And there's the backing vocal, doubled. And then he doubles the backing vocal on the next pass with a step back from the microphone.
Lay back and groove with mine. You gotta feel that heat. And we can ride the boogie, share that beat of love. I wanna rock with you all night. Dance you into the
sunlight.
I wanna rock with you.
He then also asks him to double that, but with in a stereo format using the one line pair. So to capture that stereo effect of the early reflections.
You gotta feel that heat. And we can ride the boogie, share that beat of love. I wanna rock with you all night. Dance you into the
sunlight.
I wanna rock with you all night.
We're gonna rock the night.
Out on the floor, there ain't.
Here it is in the track.
And we can ride the boogie, share that beat of love. I wanna rock with you all night. Dance you into the
sunlight.
I wanna rock with you all night.
That's why I don't get hired to edit many things. So, what's going on in this process? Well, firstly, Bruce Lydian is the agent within this process. And here, we've scaled the model to an individual level. Bruce Lydian has internalized the domain of sound engineering, a process that everyone does in their own unique way. And he's also internalized the selection criteria for the field of sound engineering. What's going to sound good, essentially? And at this point, the emergent idea is his aspect of creative practice of microphoning. And this is what he mentioned. Michael is not only the best vocalist I've ever worked with, but he loves to experiment with sound. He's always been highly supportive and very enthusiastic about my sonic ideas. In addition, Quincy Jones has always allowed me the creative freedom to bring my sonic personality to the music at hand. So, Bruce Lydian was also, we can see the creative system working at the individual level, but we can also see it working at the collective level as well. I mentioned here that Quincy Jones allowed him the creative freedom to do that. Michael Jackson, as an artist, also validated his work within that. Alvin Zack again mentions when engineers get sounds, they're not simply setting up microphones and monitoring record levels. They're balancing a complex network of interactive mediating elements that colour the sound and may affect the musician's performance as well as the decision of the recording team.
So this is working at the obvious thing is to say that it's working at a larger scale, but as soon as we say larger or above or below, we introduce a hierarchy to this thing. You've got to understand with systems that we're talking about systems within systems within systems. And this is, let's just say that this is the largest system up and scale up in this particular way. So the agency that exists here exists within the group. And you have a look at Paul Paulus's and Vernon Neistat's work on collaborative creativity. You get some sense of how that collaboration process actually works, and you can then give agency to particular groups or move up another scale again.
Yeah. Kiso has also explored this idea of creating, using specific parts of the domain and terming a micro domain, so things that are specific to the task at hand. And the agents within the creative process in the recording studio also form part of the social organization that understands and uses the domain.
Paul, can I just do a quick
question?
Yes. Before.
Yeah.
How's the distributed creativity works? Can we talk about this more? Mm-hmm.
Sorry. You've got your own talk there, Paul, especially for you.
I'll join you.
Yeah. So as Philip mentioned, this is where we see the systems within systems within systems. And we actually had a discussion about this morning, whether we should make the one at the end larger. And whether that infers a hierarchy, because there isn't necessarily a hierarchy. These are all concurrent.
There's no up and down in space.
Exactly. But you'll notice that the thing that connects them all, like an invisible skewer through them, is the record. So at some point an individual has to use their domain knowledge, rearrange it in a new way. They also evaluate that knowledge or that idea with reference to their internalized selection criteria of the field. So if you think about Carl Barat before writing songs, he's mindful of the field at that point, he's mindful about the lyrics, particularly if his previous album didn't do as well. So he's thinking about his audience at that particular point in time. Then we can see it at the group scale, where an agent or a group of agents form a micro field inside that, so they provide the evaluation for these novel ideas that use domain knowledge. And then once the record is released, then other agents, just as we saw before, audiences, music critics, post-digital intermediaries, cultural intermediaries, they decide whether that record is of value within that domain of commercial record production. I didn't miss anything up, did I?
No, you didn't.
Thanks, Phil.
So, just to conclude, and we might just do this in tandem, that confluence models of creativity, such as the one that we've been working with,
and certainly refined by Kerrigan, help to appropriately illustrate this complexity of creativity. And there's another word from systems processes, well, questions of complexity as well as scalability and emergence and complementarity and so on. And the entire argument, of course, is that creative practice comes about as a result of a creative system in action, which gets well away from our focus on individuals. I think what we've tried to do is contextualise that engineering process with just the one case. We also really need to understand that individuals are not sufficient in this entire process. And you might just leave it to you, Paul.
Sure. So the creative practice of microphoning required Bruce William to use his internalised knowledge of the domain, rearrange it in a novel way, so use the microphone techniques in a new way, to create a particular sonic effect, and then for the people involved in that process to evaluate that against the selection criteria of the field to achieve that result of recorded sound. Thank you very much.
We've got some time for questions. A lot of people in here, so I guess there's going to be some questions. So, hands up.
Yeah, I've always got one. That's fantastic, guys, that, you know, seeing you scaling the system, you know, right down to not just the engineering process, the microphone process. Mm-hmm. Are you planning future examples?
I'm glad you asked that. I've just finished writing my book. So it will be available in all good bookshops. But there is a chapter in there
just
on engineering.
Christmas.
It'll be just before Christmas as well. So I'll buy you an Amazon voucher.
But, I mean, specifically to Phil, is this where you see the study of creativity going, you know, really scaling up or down
I think it's one aspect of the study of creativity. But there was a paper that we'd done just prior to this one, actually.
Mm. Yeah.
Which we take a paperback writer and look at that as a scale process, right. Starting with Paul McCartney and then going to the dyad with McCartney and Lennon, and then going to the group inside the studio, including not only the engineers involved, but also the tech people from EMI and so on. And then we took that out into a larger socio-cultural field and put that inside the historical domain of what was occurring in the middle 60s at that particular period. So we've got a paper that does that in other areas. So I'll refer you back to that.
I'll just, not question, but just to point out something that you demonstrated,
yeah.
Which not too many people talk about or maybe even aware of, that in pop vocal production, I know you were talking engineering, we had a great example there of a pop chorus where one is not harmonizing every single word in the chorus. Yeah. You know, quite naturally, Michael's just bringing out particular lines, and that's something that's early learning of harmonising and doing pop vocals is, you've highlighted the hemicellics, I've just thought.
Can I just say, we've just demonstrated the system right at work there. The level of knowledge that's coming from Phil, in terms of his domain understanding, is identifying this in this
field, yeah.
And you're approving of it as a member of the field. So thank you, Phil.
Checks in the mail.
I think, but it also highlights something really important is that, and that Bruce William actually mentions himself, he couldn't have achieved the same effect if it was another vocalist. Michael Jackson even doubles his vibrato in certain parts, and it's quite exquisite to listen to.
I just wanted to comment on it. It's kind of interesting that the problem with spatializing these things and these nested kind of systems that you're trying to work with visually. But also the historical part of the acquisition of that knowledge, but also the way this team seems to work over time. The way Sweden's talking about how Michael is willing to experiment with it. So there's a kind of cumulative kind of effect of that teamwork, and Quincy Jones willing to accept his contribution. And I was thinking of Rob's comments about how there's these kind of very mobile teams working in the current pop kind of realm. Here's this kind of historical acquired a certain kind of way of practice that's unique to them as a group. And I don't know how you catch that, capture that, because that's part of the system.
Well, you could kind of describe it if you go back to that question we were talking about the panel this morning about things coming into being.
Yeah.
Nothing occurs in a vacuum. And if we go back to Aristotle, which we were talking about earlier from metaphysics, the things that come into being rely on a set of antecedent conditions. And they come to be something out of something. And I think what we forget is the out of something, which is the historical thing. You were talking about similarity and difference, things that are the same, things that are different. I think we forget the things that are the same that we pull into this whole process. And Rob was talking about a little earlier about the things, once again, that inside DAWs that were consistent from those prior things and things that have changed as a result of that. So I think we kind of forget the antecedent conditions when we talk about creativity, but absolutely vital to the whole process. So I think rather than actually being built into the model, I think those implications sit behind the model themselves, just in the definition of what you're dealing with.
There's also that added thing that Howard Becker talks about, is that nobody, you know, comes up with these new rules. They're already, a lot of them are already decided. So when you come to work in a particular cultural space, those codes and contexts are shared between the group. I mean, we saw it in the rave culture, and going to a journey to a rave, there were particular rules that you followed. You had to have a friend of a friend, etc. So, yeah, hopefully that answers your question. They developed the relationship, but they also, I mean, we were chatting about this morning, they each allowed each other enough space to do what they were good at. And I think that's why that trio of people worked. Certainly there were other people involved, but they were central agents within that process.
So it's not as though teams haven't existed before. The way teams interact is really quite fluid and dynamic, I think.
Yeah.
We're just doing it in a slightly different way as we move through all those technological changes.
Yeah. In a sense, the process was quite old-fashioned because it actually replicated what had been going on with Quincy. Of course, it's with the engineer taking care of the technical stuff. And, you know, Bruce had a very kind of particular creative vision using the sound of space, actually, to give character to the record. So it was actually a tradition, and actually going against, in some ways, more kind of proactive producers. But with Quincy being the arranger,
Well, I think that's the other thing that we forget. In the West, we tend to valorize the individual, we tend to valorize innovation and see those things as creativity and forget that there's this teamwork aspect of virtually everything that comes into being, but also the relationship between tradition and innovation inside systems thinking. The question of complementarity is that you don't put those things in opposition, you put them in balance together. There's a really good chapter on tradition and innovation in Keith Negus and Michael Pickering's Communication, Creativity and Cultural Production, which is one of his lesser known books that I think talks literally about that relationship between tradition and innovation and how important that really is.
I think we've got time for one more. Justin, did you?
Yeah. Before you were talking about the model on the left and you were describing the fans, and that's almost understood you, the fans. Journalists from the 80s.
No,
the, right. I must have misunderstood you.
The field, the field of commercial record production. It's made of audiences, fans, and so they decide whether the record is creative or not.
Yeah.
And that also has a historical component. Certain records are.
Because that was completely against my misunderstanding of what it was about. So
right.
I just checked.
Yeah.
I did have one really dull question as well, which is how did you get the multi tracks?
Yeah.
We all went to that one.
I'm currently recording, so couldn't possibly tell you.
That's a whole other case.
I'll throw one more into the pot because we privately had some of these discussions, and it comes into some of the stuff I've already done with Paul and Phyllis helped us. But I'm still struggling with this. Partly, through, you know, you've shown us a system, and as you pointed out, this is a system that Swillane, Quincy Jones, Michael have probably done many times, so probably, you know, all step back, Michael, and those things you've described, still comes across to me as a linear process, because they've done it before, they've created a system,
And I'm still struggling with my sort of, you know, describing my pop systems and feeling that I've tried to start off with a creative linear process, but as Phil has quite rightly persuaded me, it is non-linear because so many things change within that. But we just saw a process there that was quite linear, really.
Yeah.
Just talking about the microphone and the yeah. stages.
Yeah. Well, I think as soon as you introduce the chapel element, you've got some linearity in the process. But when you were talking yesterday about which is virtual design thinking, you kept adding in the iterative loops in the process. And at some point, you recognize that this is no longer linear at all. In fact, it's non-linear and it's systemic. And those ideas are coming in an instantaneous way. Sometimes they're coming across a lifetime. And it's when we look at it in a time sense that we tend to want to introduce the question of linearity. But I think the process itself is really quite non-linear.
That's what I was going to say.
That's just an assertion, isn't it?
Well, one of these conferences, we need to take a vote.
but it is a recursive process. I mean, we're only listening to the multi-tracks that made it.
Yeah.
What would be nice to do is, if we could possibly get hold of them, is the ones that didn't. Yeah. And that gives us a point of reference as to how they judged a particular performance, which made it through that period of practice.
There's a methodological question there about non-linearity. Wouldn't it be marvellous to actually be Bruce Sweden and be in the location and have some understanding of how that thing came into being? He probably couldn't voice that, but it was going like this. You know?
Yeah.
Whereas we can take film of this, we can try an ethnographic process, we can interview them, we can observe them. We only get close. We can't get right into the actual system itself. That's the difficulty that we have with non-linearity.
Well, some of us can if we're there in the process, and you know, kind of what I'm trying to say is I've witnessed and worked in linear processes. You know, I worked with a vocalist from Matt Gankert with Basher, who got to a stage in her harmonising in a similar process to this, did her own backing vocals. By album two, she insisted that the engineer, the producer, and everyone else stepped out of the room. She took control at the desk and did all of her own backing vocals and harmonies, but knew exactly what you know. She didn't turn to anyone and say, is that all right, is that fit? She just, you know, and you step back in the room, and it's all done. she knew exactly what she wanted to do, and she had, you know, a straight line method of getting it.
Thanks for that, Bill. Because what you demonstrated there is that she internalized the selection criteria for the field, for pop performance. She knew what was expected and what it should sound like.
The University of Huddersfield, inspiring tomorrow's professionals.